Coming up on ITV News London, the Met Police apologises to Stephen Lawrence's family for failing to investigate a sixth murder suspect properly. The row over Winston Churchill's place in history at St Paul's Cathedral. And Elton John's last big night, the Rocket Man settles down for a quieter life after Glastonbury. After the break, a sixth suspect is named 30 years on for the murder of Stephen Lawrence. And the Met Police apologises to Stephen's family. Tonight, the new suspect in the murder of Stephen Lawrence is named. Matthew White's accused of leading the group of attackers who carried out Stephen's racist murder back in 1993. Police failings meant he was never charged.
It was already there all the time, and the police didn't use it to try and catch all the killers who killed my son, the people who killed my son.
Also tonight, St Paul's Cathedral provokes anger after describing Winston Churchill as a white supremacist on its website. We're with Prince William in Brixton as he launches a new project to tackle homelessness and...
Yeah, we came from that block life, where guys make moves and they're not nice. Lord knows how we got by. My boy's dead, but his killer still got
Governor life. B will be in the studio talking about his new album and turning his racist attack into art. Good evening. In the 30 years since the racist murder of Stephen Lawrence, the details of the Metropolitan Police's mishandling of the case is well known. And yet, more information about their shoddy police work is still coming to light. Another suspect has today been revealed following a BBC investigation, Matthew White. He's accused of leading the gang towards Stephen the night he was killed. Except he isn't a new suspect. The police were aware of him in the immediate aftermath, and due to their own mistakes, he wasn't arrested until 2000 and then again in 2013. On both occasions, there wasn't enough evidence to prosecute. Matthew White died in 2021. Our correspondent Simon Harris has followed the case ever since Stephen was murdered in 1993.
Eltham Police Station, 1993, and in the incident room, detectives investigating the murder of Stephen Lawrence have been given names of five suspects. But 30 years on, it's emerged there was a sixth person under surveillance. He's Matthew White, who died in 2021 at the age of 50. He was arrested twice by the murder squad and twice released without charge.
I'm shocked and disappointed at some of the information I'm seeing now. It was already there all the time, and the police didn't use it to try and catch all the killers who killed my son, the people who killed my son.
Stephen was stabbed to death close to a bus stop in Eltham in April 1993. The botched police investigation became the subject of a public inquiry, which concluded the Metropolitan Police was institutionally racist. The five suspects were called to give evidence, but refused to answer questions.
The names of the five suspects in this case have long been known. Two of them were convicted of Stephen's murder and are in prison. But this is the first time a possible sixth member of the gang has been identified.
Stephen's friend Dwayne Brooks was the only witness to the murder. He told officers there were six in the gang, but police treated Dwayne as a suspect.
I'm not surprised that yet another piece of evidence that Dwayne Brooks gave the police at the time of the murder has been shown to be crucial, and yet was dissed at the time of his first statements to the police and has been dissed since.
The documentary accuses the police of disregarding eyewitness descriptions, including one from Dwayne Brooks.
White also looked like he fits an artist impressions by eyewitnesses at the bus stop. They weren't given the chance to see him in a police lineup.
In a statement, Stephen's mother, Baroness Doreen Lawrence, said, "The failure to properly investigate a main suspect in a murder case is so grave that it should be met by serious sanctions. Only when police officers lose their jobs can the public have confidence that failure and incompetence will not be tolerated and that change will happen."
The Lawrence family have had to go through years and years of discovering yet further failings from the police service, deep institutional racially driven failings, and today's yet another example of that.
Scotland Yard said when police questioned Matthew White, he denied any involvement in Stephen's murder. But, a senior officer conceded, too many mistakes were made in the initial investigation.
I mean, Simon, we're finding out about this name 30 years after Stephen's murder. The police have kept these mistakes well hidden, haven't they?
I mean, it is frankly extraordinary that it's taken 30 years for the existence of a sixth suspect to emerge. It appears that the police were given Matthew White's name by a number of sources back in 1993, including one of his relatives. We know that Dwayne Brooks said there were six people in the gang and that one of them had fair hair. So why wasn't Matthew White arrested and treated as a suspect? Why was he treated as a witness? Why wasn't he put into an identity parade? Why was it that the police apparently missed a potential opportunity to catch one of the killers? I mean, when White was finally arrested and questioned, it was 7 years after Stephen's murder. It's hardly surprising that CPS concluded there simply wasn't enough evidence to charge him.
Simon, thanks very much. Next tonight, the campaign by Zara Alina's aunt to force killers to face their victim's family in court. Zara was attacked and killed in June last year, but her murderer refused to appear in court and face her family when he was sentenced to 38 years in prison. Well, today, her aunt, Farah Naz, took her campaign to the Ministry of Justice and Kaf Okpata was with her.
A year ago today, Zara Alina's life was taken from her. She was sexually assaulted and then murdered. Her killer, Jordan McSweeney, was sentenced to 38 years for murder, but not once has he heard the impact his crime has had on Zara's family.
If there was a motto that Zara would have, it would be always do your best. She did her best at everything.
Today, her aunt is doing as Zara said. She's here to meet the Secretary of State for Justice to campaign for a change in the law.
Victims need to be empowered, and so I'm here to talk about the Victims Bill. I'm here to talk about the justice system, what we've been through in the last year, how disempowered we have felt.
At the end of the trial, Jordan McSweeney failed to attend his sentencing hearing, and speaking to Zara's aunt, you can tell it's something which has really stuck with her. In fact, it's one of the reasons she's coming here. She wants to make it compulsory for all killers to face their victim's family in court when they've been sentenced. Her meeting was scheduled to last for half an hour. Instead, it ran for double that time, and when she came out, seemingly positive news.
How are you? What is going to be done about sentenced convicts avoiding, convicted felons avoiding sentence hearing? And what we just got from that meeting is Alex Chalk has promised to push forward that legislation.
It's a promise which has been made before. Three justice secretaries have told Farah the same thing since her niece was killed.
We have had a commitment today. I suppose the frustration that both of us feel is how quickly will that happen?
In a statement, the Ministry of Justice said perpetrators of such crimes should face the consequences of their actions by attending court. That's why we're working on proposals to change the law so families see justice being served. This change in the law could take months, possibly years, but for Farah, that is no deterrent. She continues to make her case in honour of her niece's memory. Kaf Opata, ITV News.
A man's appeared in court charged with the murder of an elderly woman in South London. 76-year-old Nelly Okoma was found in a house in Ladbroke Road, Croydon, last Wednesday. Hugo de Silva Perez, who's 28, was arrested last Friday and appeared at Bromley Magistrate Court today. A 31-year-old woman also appeared in court, charged with fraud and perverting the course of justice. Low traffic neighbourhoods certainly divide opinion, but to what extent do they divide communities? On one side, there's the environmental impact, but on the other are those who insist that they're a nuisance. Well, Hackney has more LTNs than any other London borough. And in Stoke Newington, businesses say they're losing money as customers are struggling to get to them. Helen Keenan's been speaking to some of them.
A subject that has sparked much debate, low traffic neighbourhoods. The benefits include better air quality, but businesses in Stoke Newington say it's cutting the number of customers they're getting through the door.
A journey that used to take us 5 minutes can take us 15, 20, 25, because we have to go all the way around the houses.
Which means you're inevitably doing less business.
We are, and I mean, we've tried to hold back the prices, But it's difficult.
Their business rates have increased by around £2,000 each year. Combined with the LTN, they say the result is dwindling customer numbers and concerns for the future of independent businesses here.
Businesses say it's affecting trade and they say the signs are confusing. On this sign, you can actually turn both right and left, but they say it's putting off customers.
Sooner or later, I think there will be a fatality because of the main reason being people are going to be so confused by the signage, they're not going to be looking where they're going.
At this mechanics, they want the LTN to be adapted and only operate during rush hour.
For if people had a problem with their tyre, flat battery, OK, where can I go locally? OK, I'm passing. Oh, there's a garage there. Let me stop. Now there is that. There's no passing.
Sitting side by side, but with opposing views, the LTN is a talking point for local residents.
For people who have to go out and do locksmiths and et cetera, et cetera, it's an inconvenience. They have to work it out, I think.
It collects more traffic, and I've walked down that traffic, you know, on green lanes.
Olivia has a disability. Sometimes she's in so much pain she has to drive. LTNs have made that so difficult, she's now moving out of the area.
Absolutely trapped in, but for going down Church Street. And now I have to sit in local traffic. I'm outside a school, I'm outside low-income housing.
We put all these points to the Councillor for Environment and Transport in Hackney.
It's good for footfall. We've widened the pavements, we've got more people cycling, more people active, much better air quality. But of course, you know, like, you know, if businesses or anyone else has any ideas about how we can improve the scheme, we're obviously open to listen to them.
The concern for the future of local businesses here in Stoke Newington is an issue that isn't slowing down. Helen Keenan, ITV News.
Next, St Paul's Cathedral has been caught up in a row over Sir Winston Churchill's reputation and place in history. On their websites, they describe the Prime Minister who led the country in World War II as an imperialist and a white supremacist. Well, Antoine Allen is at the cathedral for us now. And Antoine, they've actually taken down those comments now, haven't they?
Yeah, so, well, St Paul's holds a special significance to Sir Winston Churchill and his family. It was here in 1965 that his state funeral was held. On St Paul's website, they describe what happened that day, as well as Sir Winston Churchill's role in defeating Nazi Germany. But also, for over a year, they described Sir Winston Churchill as a figure of controversy, as he was an unashamed imperialist and a white supremacist. Now, this opinion of Churchill beyond his leadership during World War II has been debated by historians and social commentators in recent times due to Churchill's controversial comments about race. But on Friday, the website changed the wording they had for Sir Winston Churchill. It now reads, a figure of controversy, especially when viewed from a modern perspective. This was due to complaints. Sir Winston Churchill's own grandson, Sir Nicholas Soames, said that the family were upset by the offensive and ignorant remarks on the original website. Now, St Paul's has said that they're reviewing all of their history pages to ensure that the language is appropriate and contextual.
Okay, Anton, thanks very much. Still to come on the programme, how the new number one in tennis is hoping for more success in London, and
he came in, gave me a hug, he came and spoke to the choir and was just like, I love you guys. And people are like, you know who we are.
Choir with Rebecca Thomas, the choir director. Come on.
That, of course, was the London Gospel Choir, who was singing with Elton John over the weekend. We've been catching up with them. But first, Prince William was in Brixton today to launch a new £3 million project to tackle homelessness. At the launch, he said that his commitment to the cause was inspired by his mum, who first took him to visit a homeless shelter when he was 11. And it's raised questions about whether the prince is moving into politics, as Daniel Henry reports.
Prince William has never been homeless. Today, he says no one else should be either.
Too many people have found themselves without a stable and permanent place to call home. Through these visits, I have seen firsthand the breadth and complexities of homelessness.
The cameras came out for his campaign to end rough sleeping, as they did nearly 30 years ago when his mum campaigned on the same issue.
I first visited a homelessness shelter when I was 11 with my mother. The visits we made together left a deep and lasting impression. So, I am pleased to stand here today at the start of our path to ending homelessness.
David was listening closely. He spent time with Prince William in the past and believes his help will lead to a brighter future.
You see, when I meet people, I know if they're genuine, because I meet a lot of people. And just the fact he came round to my pitch, he gave his word, and so he did. With this project, he's true to his word again. He's here, and he's going to make a difference, that's the thing.
The Prince's project will be piloted in Lambeth, the first of six locations that experts will find ways to end homelessness.
I think it's important. It's important that everyone gets involved, because the more hands-on, the more we can fight against homelessness. And with his title, it will help be like, oh, he really cares.
Kensington Palace say this isn't a PR stunt. This is about trying to change the way we as a society think about homelessness. We'll soon find out if he's able to reach that goal. Daniel Henry, ITV News.
Well, there's a new king at Queen's, and he intends to reign at Wimbledon and dominate tennis around the world for years to come. Carlos Alcaraz took his first grass court title yesterday. In the process, the 20-year-old Spaniard became the world number one. He spoke to our reporter, Rex Martel.
The crowning of a new king at Queen's. Carlos Alcaraz is only 20, but after this win in West London, moves back to number one in the tennis world.
Enhorabuena, campeón.
Thank you, enhorabuena. Gracias, muchas gracias.
And the new champion sat down with ITV News with the Queen's trophy that has yet to be engraved.
Has it got your name on you?
Oh, yeah.
Carlos, congratulations. When we spoke earlier last week, you said you had a lot to learn on grass. What have you learnt by winning Queen's?
Well, I learned how to move well on grass. You know, I learned a lot of things during this amazing week. You know, I got a lot of experience playing on grass, you know, and right now I know a lot of things about, you know, playing well on grass.
When Alcaraz won the US Open last year, he became the youngest number one in the history of the men's game.
Shall we play some tennis?
Yes, please.
Let's do it.
Grand comparisons have already been made with the tennis greats, like Roger Federer, who was on centre court with Princess Kate ahead of the championships.
The tennis focus now moves to Wimbledon, and after winning Queen's, Alcaraz will be the top seed here in the men's draw, but he's not the favourite.
Novak Djokovic seems hungry for more grass success after winning his record 23rd Grand Slam.
What are your chances of winning Wimbledon now?
You know, my expectation to Wimbledon increased a lot, but obviously there are a lot of great players that are experienced more than me on grass. The main player, you know, to win the Wimbledon is Novak, but I have to have credit on myself, and I see myself lifting the trophy.
Good luck.
Confident words from the new King of Queens, but true tennis greatness will only come if he can make this place his kingdom. Rags Martel, ITV News, Wimbledon.
Now, our guest tonight, Governor B, is a multi-award winning songwriter and performer and author whose latest album, The Village is on Fire, has been inspired by his experience of racist attack, which left him blind for months back in 2021. The results of the attack form part of the album cover that you can see now. The men who attacked him were never found and the case closed by the Metropolitan Police. And before we talk to him, let's hear a clip.
I don't know if that's going to be as fulfilling as writing it down, which I know probably sounds ridiculous to say. Just think about how you can use it creatively.
Go figure. Trying to do my best, trying to keep my chin up. Gotta stop myself from getting bitter. To some people, I'll always be a...
Well, that's the lead song from the album called Bridgeland Road, which features the voice of his cousin, the actor Michaela Cole, who encouraged him to write about his experience. Governor B, it's such a joy to have you in the studio. I mean, I remember listening to that lead track, Bridgetown, when it was first released, and it's emotive, but beautiful, and really honest about what it was that you went through. It actually made me quite emotional the first time I listened to it and subsequently. Do you mind talking through what happened to you that day?
Yeah, sure. I was in my local area, went to grab a coffee, and I was walking over to my car, and there were three white guys in front of it. I said, excuse me, please. They pretended as though they couldn't hear me. I said it once more and no response. So I kind of gently brushed past one. And within the space of about 10 seconds, one of them threw coffee in my eye, followed by a punch to the face.
Just out of nowhere?
Just out of the blue. And this was broad daylight. It was actually quite emotional hearing the Stephen Lawrence news today, because this was literally 5 minutes from where he was murdered. And in my mind, we've come a long way since, but obviously not far enough.
Yeah, I mean, they weren't able to find the perpetrators who attacked you, were they? The Metropolitan Police ended up closing the case. Yeah. I mean, how do you deal with the anger and rage that you may well have felt? Is that what putting it into words is all about?
I think so. To be really honest, I found it quite difficult to deal with the anger and the rage. I'm normally quite an optimistic person, but it was really hard. And my cousin, Michaela Cole, who's on that song, she encouraged me to use my art form to try and process. It can be quite a cathartic experience. Yeah, massively. Obviously, I'd love for the perpetrators to be brought to justice one day, but for now, it's done the job.
And what was the recovery like? Because you were blind for quite a while, weren't you?
Yeah, I couldn't see out of my left eye properly. I was getting flashes for a couple of months, and it was just a reminder of what happened. Yeah. But thankfully, I'm grateful that I've got my vision back.
I mean, it is a really beautiful album, and it covers so many different subjects. You don't hold back from speaking the truth as to, I guess, your view of the world.
No, I don't. With my art, I try and comfort the disturbed and disturb the comfortable. I think if we don't talk about issues that affect our society and face them head on, then we're just delaying the inevitable. I've got kids now and I want them to grow up in a safer environment. So for me, it's important to face these issues.
Now, I'm going to get to the kids in just a minute and your hugely successful TikTok account. But I wanted to ask about your faith, because did you struggle with your faith after the attack?
I did, actually, because I'm a Christian. I didn't really know what to pray, because it was obviously like a really difficult situation and I lost hope in humanity. And I thought, even after George Floyd, it seems as though even though people have learned what not to say, N-word, etc., it hasn't necessarily changed their innermost stereotypes. Yeah. And how do we push that forward? But I think my faith is something that gives me light at the end of the tunnel and helps me wake up and fight another day.
Now, this has been one of the producers very excited about your TikTok account, because you also show quite a bit of your family on there, which is a really nice side to you. Have you been enjoying doing that?
I have. I think there's probably a misconception sometimes that black men or men from council estate culture are distant dads, but I actually really enjoy being a dad, and I love fatherhood.
So amazing. Yeah. Now, the London Gospel Choir performed with Elton John not that long ago, and it was a beautiful performance, wasn't it? And you've been talking to them, haven't you?
Well, can you guess who I am? Elton John. Let's have a look. Here he is, the London Gospel Choir.
If this was goodbye, then what a hello. With the massive audience in the palm of his hands, Elton delivered hit after hit after hit.
And it seemed to me you lived your life like a candle in the wind.
His legs might not move as fast anymore, but his fingers can still perfectly caress the keys into a showstopper. Also accompanying him, a very eager crowd.
It's a little bit funny, this feeling inside.
Among Elton's special Glastonbury guests, a little bit of London.
The London Community Gospel Choir with Rebecca Thomas, the choir director.
In production rehearsals on Thursday and Friday, he came in, gave me a hug. Yeah. He came and spoke to the choir and was just like, I love you guys. And people were like, you know who we are, kind of thing still. He was just like, I love you guys. You know, you guys are going to sound amazing. Then when he heard us, every time we finished a song, he was like, oh my God. Yeah. It's just like.
Meanwhile, his beloved football club, Watford, posted their praise on Twitter. Absolutely brilliant. We love you, Elton. But uncertainty continued to hang in the hot night air about whether this really would be Elton's last show.
It's a very special and emotional night for me, because it may be my last show ever in England and Great Britain. I'm still standing. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
The knight even captured a proposal. Their happy start, possibly to Elton's happy ending.
He just can't help but sing along. He's just an absolute legend. What a great opportunity for the London Gospel Choir.
I know. What a special, special day for them. Special day as well for me yesterday. Got a text from my mum saying, "Hey, Sal and Matt, happy anniversary."
We both completely
forgot.
Did you forget?
Both of us completely forgot. Isn't that awful? Oh, my goodness.
Well, you'll have to get each other some lovely gifts this week.
I think we need to sing a few more Elton John love songs to each other. Anyway, that can be arranged, no problem. He'll hate it. Anyway, here's the weather. Let's take a look.
ITV London weekday weather is sponsored by Octopus Electric Vehicles. Car, charger and energy.
Hello again. I hope you had a good start to the week. This little one had an exhausting Monday. There we go, resting up on its parent. Feeling a little bit fresher this week and turning cloudier as we go through tonight and tomorrow. And if you're wondering about rain when our next bout is, it's likely to be later on Wednesday and overnight. So let's take a little look at the detail for you. We've got quite a lot of high cloud moving in overnight tonight. So by tomorrow morning, it won't be quite as bright as it was this morning. Our temperature's staying up into double figures, but it's a little less muggy, a little bit more comfortable for sleeping. I'm sure you'll be relieved to hear. And then tomorrow, the best of any brightness early and to the east, but there's quite a lot of cloud around and more thickening up and moving in from the west. A tiny bit of rain could make its way into the north far part of the world, but generally dry. Temperatures down a touch, highs of 20 to 23. And similar story in the evening. Again, just a risk of a little bit of rain moving in the further north you are, but plenty of dry weather around. As we head into Wednesday, there's a risk of a shower perhaps in the afternoon, but the main bit of rain we're looking at is coming off this front as it moves through later on in the evening and overnight. Could be some heavy bursts on it, actually. It does clear through Thursday morning and Thursday improves, but you'll notice from the outlook one other thing, and that is our temperatures are returning back to around average for this time of year. Here's the pollen.
ITV London weekday weather is sponsored by Octopus Electric Vehicles.
Hello, summer. Piri sponsors ITV Pollen Count.
So we seem to be past the main peak for grass and nettle pollen, although levels are still high over the next few days, maybe slightly eased off now the weather is not quite so hot. Take care. I'll see you later on. Cheerio.
Well, that's it from us for now. The ITV News at 6:30 is up next with Gamal. But for now, from all of us on the London team, enjoy your evening. Bye-bye.